Please join me in welcoming Dr. Mark Namani, who is a neurobiologist newly hired into our program, and he is speaking on unlocking the regenerative potential of the adult brain.
Thank you, Erica. It is a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much for coming. My family and I moved here about 3 months ago from Boston. Loving living in Tacoma, loving teaching here, and just so thrilled to be a part of our new biomedical sciences major. So I'm going to give you a very brief kind of overview of the overarching... Okay, there we go. So I'm going to give you a brief overview. I'm a walker, sorry. I'm going to give you a brief overview of the overarching theme of my research in the lab. And I'd like to start with this image, which you may not be able to see very well with the lights, but you can hopefully tell is a galaxy, our galaxy, the Milky Way, which, as it turns out, has about 100 billion stars or so. And I'd like to show this because this is the central portion of the galaxy, so you can imagine there are a lot more of these little dots. And the human brain, your brains, consist of approximately 100 billion neurons. So you can think about every one of these tiny points of light and many more fitting into your brain. And that's not all. Not only do you have that many neurons, the cells in your brain that connect to each other and perform everything from the thinking or not thinking that you're doing right now to being able to balance on your chairs, but every one of those neurons is connected through trillions of connections to other neurons, right? And it is the precise activation of these synapses, these connections, and these neurons that allow you to do the specific behaviors that you do every day. And I think you can start to then get a handle on how complex of a job your brain has, and even more so, what a complex job it has if you get injured. Having to regenerate each one of those specific connections in a way that will allow you to regain the specific function that it subserves, right? And so I like to show this, which is the regeneration of your peripheral nervous system. So our central nervous system is our brain and our spinal cord. The peripheral nervous system is all the nerves that go out to the rest of your body. And it turns out that if you were to cut your finger here, this is what you would see, or you wouldn't see it, but it would happen, hopefully, is that your nerve would that was severed would find its partner eventually, and it would regenerate. And eventually you would get sensation back in your finger. I've done this, it happens. But unfortunately for us, for adults, past puberty or so, if you have a stroke, if you're unfortunate to have a neurodegenerative disease or a traumatic brain injury, your brain cannot regenerate after a great amount of destruction, a great amount of degeneration, right? But thankfully, there is some hope, and that hope comes in the form of something called a critical period. Right? So this is just a simple graph showing you how a particular brain repaired itself. So this is the amount of repair of the brain, or the plasticity. Plasticity is how malleable the connections are. And this is the number of days after the injury. So you can tell here is that when you're born, your brain has a low amount of malleability and has a low ability to repair itself. But there is this sweet spot for this particular brain, somewhere between 7 days of age and 21 days of age, where if you were to have an injury, that's where you want that injury to happen, right? Right during that sweet spot, right? So we call that critical periods. And I think observationally, you know critical periods from your own lives. If you've had children, you've watched them learn a language without any accent. That's the critical period for language. If you try to learn a language after puberty, you will have an accent. If you try to learn the piano when you're my age, you will have a difficult time. You will have a much easier time during the critical period for learning that type of a motor skill, which is early on in life, again, before puberty. So there are these critical periods, not only for brain malleability, but also for your brain to be able to repair itself. And the idea is that if we can learn some of the lessons, how the brain is able to do this during this period, we can use those lessons to help restart connections, repair when we need it. Okay? So I like to show this video. This is Conrad Lorenz, who popularized this idea of critical periods, because it shows how dramatic a critical period can be. So these are little gray lag geese, and this is the critical period for imprinting. Imprinting is where animals, in this case geese, will hatch, and they have about 10 hours after they hatch to find their caregiver. After that time, whatever they've seen during those 10 hours, that's their caregiver. If it's a tree, that's their caregiver. If it's a box, that's their caregiver. If it's Conrad, that's their caregiver. Right? This is their critical period for imprinting. So in those 10 hours, they saw Conrad, and he is now their caregiver. So they will follow him everywhere he goes. He's pretty cruel. He runs away. And they'll swim with him. They will go everywhere with him because they went through that period, that 10 hours, that critical period for them to find their caregiver, and the first thing they saw was Conrad, and that critical period ended. So what fascinates me about critical periods is how malleable the system is, how malleable the brain has to be of these geese to be able to change its connectivity, the way that it behaves, to make anything their caregiver, right? The function is so plastic, but it's also so static, so it ends really abruptly, and after that period, the circuit, the brain, is essentially static. It's not able to change anymore. You could bring a mother goose in there and they wouldn't care because the system is now the way that it's going to be for the rest of the geese's lives. And so if we can understand what starts and stops these huge periods for brain plasticity, we can use those lessons to restart plasticity in our brains when we need them, such as after injury. All right, so how do I go about doing this? Well, a number of ways, and this is just one. I use the visual system as a model because we know a lot about the visual system, and it turns out that the visual system, this happens to be Xenopus laevis. This is a frog. This is a tadpole that I use. The visual system of this tadpole is very similar to the organization of your visual system, believe it or not. And it also displays amazing abilities to regenerate its brain during the critical period when it is a tadpole. And so I'll show you an example of that. So here is a tiny tadpole. You're going to see him move in a minute. It's this little black dot. And these white dots are a projector that's projecting a scene from underneath. Okay? And these dots are going to move in a second. It's a movie. And the little tadpole's in a water bath that he likes to swim in. And the little white dots are going to move. And this little tadpole has something called an optokinetic response. Opto meaning eyes, kinetic meaning movement. So it is able to move in response to something that's in its environment. And white dots are very scary for the tadpole because white dots could eat the tadpole. So the tadpole is going to try to get away. So hopefully you're going to see that happen here. So here's the tadpole. Whoa, those dots are scary. He's down here. He's gonna come back up. No, scary, right? And so that's what a tadpole will try to do if you have a big fish or a little white dot. It wants to get away. That's its optokinetic response. But if you make if there's a tiny injury to this little tadpole's brain, right, thinner than the width of one of your hairs, it will lose that response completely. So here is one of those guys who has lost the response, right? So he does not, or she does not care at all, right? Just swimming along, doesn't care at all. The fascinating part is that that tadpole will look exactly like that tadpole in 1 week. Its brain will regenerate, and it will behave exactly as it did before it was injured. And so the question then is, what are the cells that are doing that? What are the connections that are doing that? What are the molecules that are able to enable this incredible recovery, this incredible functional recovery. It recovers the response and the recovery of the brain, which is subserving that response, right? So this is really what my lab is involved in, trying to figure out what the nitty-gritty is of these connections so that we can use that information to help us restart our brain plasticity when we have an injury, traumatic brain injuries, or neurodegeneration. All right, so with that, I want to thank you so much for listening. And